Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, and thank you for tuning in to our broadcast, Our Smoky Mountain Home, brought to you by Chocolate-Covered Caramel Gumdrop Cereal, part of a healthy breakfast. In tonight's episode, you'll be flies on the wall as Grandpa pays his weekly visit. Let's listen.
Hey, Ma, are you sure Grandpa is coming?
Yes, Jack. Like I said the last three times you asked, he will be here. He's just running a mite late.
A mite late? We thought he'd be here for supper.
Give your Grandpa a break, Maggie. Just be glad he likes coming to see you kids and that you like having him here. Wait. I think I hear him now.
Hello, are Maggie and Jack in here?
Grandpa, it's about time. What took you so long?
Well, I had a heck of a time getting Seabiscuit and Manowar harnessed and hitched to the wagon. You know how frisky they get in cold weather.
Grandpa, it's 80 degrees outside and you drive a Ford, not a horse wagon.
Yeah, well, that's one way of looking at it, I reckon.
Are you going to be able to tell us a story?
Well, it is Thursday evening. What usually happens on Thursday evening?
You come over to tell us a story.
Before we go to bed.
Exactly. So I guess all is right with the world then. Let me just go hang up my hat and go, and I'll be right with you.
Grandpa, you don't have a hat or a goat, and you don't hang up a goat anyway.
By gum, you're right as usual, Jack, my boy. Then let us get on with it, shall we? All right, then. Are you both all brushed up and ready for bed?
Yes.
And have you got all your school things packed and ready for tomorrow?
Yes.
Can we please get to the story now?
You pups are always in such a rush. You know, if you slow down a little, you'd enjoy life more. All right, now let's all settle down. Let me see. I've got my book right here. Let's see. Ah, here's one we haven't done before. It's called The Time That Maggie and Jack Watched the Grass Grow.
That's not a real story. That's one of your fake stories.
Come on, Grandpa. We want a real story.
All right. Here's one. I can't believe we haven't done this one before. It is the tale of Rumpelstiltskin.
By the side of a wood, in a country a long way off, and at a time long ago, ran a fine stream of water, and upon the stream there stood a mill. The miller's house was close by, and the miller, you must know, had a very beautiful daughter. She was, moreover, very shrewd and clever, and the miller was so proud of her. Now, it happened one day that the king of the land came to hunt in the wood nearby, and he stopped at the miller's house to rest. To give himself consequence, the miller told the king that his daughter could spin gold out of straw.
Oh, I know ours appears to be a poor village with not much to offer, but what if I were to tell you that my daughter can spin gold from straw?
Spin gold out of straw, eh? Well, I must say this is a thing I have never before come across.
Father, what are you doing?
And I have no idea how she came to have this talent, but she is certainly a wonder to us all.
Now, this king was very fond of money, and when he heard the miller's boast, his greediness was raised, and he said to the miller,
"This is an art that pleases me well. If thy daughter is as clever as you say, bring her to my castle tomorrow, that I may put her to the proof.
So the girl was brought to him the following day, and the king led her into a room that was quite full of straw. He gave her a wheel and spindle and said,
"Now set to work, and if by the early morning thou hast not spun this straw to gold, thou shalt die."
Whoa, that's kind of harsh, ain't it?
Yeah, I don't get it, Grandpa. Why is he being so mean?
I have no idea, children. Kings could sometimes be dangerous creatures in the olden days, I guess. Now to resume.
And he turned to...
I would just say that I didn't like this place and that I want to go home.
Yeah, she should just point and holler, "Where's that?" And when they look over there, she could just run away.
Yes, yes, it's very odd, children. Now, can I continue?
Yes.
And he turned to leave the chamber. It was in vain that the poor maiden said that it was only a silly boast of her father.
Wait, Your Majesty, my father is talking foolishness. Neither I nor anyone could do such a thing as spin straw into gold.
But the king paid her no heed and strode out of the room. The chamber door was locked and she was left alone. And so the poor miller's daughter was left sitting there and could not think what to do for her life. She had no notion how to set to work to spin gold from straw, and her distress grew so great that she began to weep. Then all at once the door opened and in came a little man who said,
"Good evening, miller's daughter. Why are you crying?"
"Oh,"
answered the girl,
"oh, little man, I have got to spin gold out of straw, and I don't understand the business."
Then the little man said,
"What will you give me if I spin it for you?"
"Oh, if you could do me this favor, I would gladly give you my necklace,"
said the girl.
"Ah, that is a very nice little prize. It shall do very well."
The little man took the necklace, seated himself before the wheel, and began to sing aloud.
"Roundabout, roundabout, lo and behold, veil away, straw into gold."
And the wheel spun around, whirr, 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 three times round, and the bobbin was full. Then he took up another, and whirr, 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 three times round, and that was full. And so he went on till the morning. Finally, all the straw had been spun, and all the bobbins were full of gold thread. At sunrise came the king, and when he saw the gold, he was astonished and very much rejoiced, for he was very avaricious.
What's avaricious mean, Grandpa?
It means he was very greedy, and he certainly sounds greedy to me, don't you think?
He sure does, and not very nice.
He had the miller's daughter taken into another room, filled with straw, much bigger than the last, and told her,
"As you value your life, you must spin it all into gold this night as you did before. Fail in this and your life is forfeit."
The king left the girl to her tortured thoughts. She did not know what to do, so she began to cry as she worried about her cruel fate. In a short while, as before, the door opened and the little man appeared.
"What will you give me this time if I spin all this straw into gold?"
"Oh, if you could do me this boon, little man, the ring from my finger would be yours,"
answered the girl.
"Ah, such a pretty little bauble. It will go well on my small finger."
So the little man took the ring and began to send the wheel whirring round.
"Roundabout, roundabout, lo and behold, wheel away, straw into gold."
And by the next morning, all the straw was spun into glistening gold. The king was rejoiced beyond measure at the sight. But as he could never have enough of gold, he had the miller's daughter taken into a still larger room full of straw and said,
"This too must be spun in one night, and if you accomplish it, you shall be my wife."
Wait, what?
First he says she has to die if she doesn't spin the gold, and now he says that if she does it, they have to get married?
That doesn't make sense, Grandpa.
What can I say, kids? I didn't write the darn thing. This is the story that we got before us. Now, shall I continue, or should we switch to the tale about Maggie and Jack watching the paint dry?
Continue.
Continue.
Now, where was I? Here.
For he thought,
"Although she is but a miller's daughter, I am not likely to find anyone richer in the whole world."
Avaricious.
Are you too quiet, Dunn?
As soon as the girl was left alone, the little man appeared for the third time and said,
"What will you give me if I spin the straw for you this time?"
"I have nothing left to give,"
answered the girl.
"Then you must promise me the first child you have after you are queen,"
said the little man.
"My first child? What a horrific notion. But who knows whether that will happen? My great trouble is upon me now,"
thought the girl. And as she did not know what else to do in her necessity, she promised the little man what he desired. Upon making this agreement, he began to spin while he sang a song, and continued until all the straw was gold. And when in the morning the king came and found all done according to his wish, he called for the wedding to be arranged at once.
"You are indeed a marvel, to be sure,"
he shouted to the girl, and to his chief minister he said,
"Summon all the noble men and women, thanes and courtiers. Have the great hall made ready. We shall have this royal wedding 3 days hence, and it shall be the most memorable occasion."
And just like that, it came to pass. The miller's pretty daughter became a queen, and in a year's time, she brought a fine child into the world and thought no more of the little man. But you can be sure that he thought much of her. So, of course, it happened one day that he suddenly came into her room.
"Hello, Your Majesty. I'm sure you remember your old friend,"
he said with cruelty dripping from his every word.
"Oh, no, not you."
"Yes, it is I. You know where I come from. Agreements must be kept. Now give me what you promised me."
The queen was terrified greatly and tried to dissuade the little man from his fiendish plan.
"Oh, please, kind fellow, I will give you any of the riches in the kingdom if you would only leave the child."
But the little man would not be moved, and he said,
"No, I would rather have something living than all the treasures in the world."
Then the queen began to lament and to weep so that the little man finally felt a mite of pity for her.
"I will give you 3 days,"
said he.
"And if at the end of that time you cannot tell my name, you must give up the child to me."
And he vanished as quickly as he had come. Then the queen spent the whole night in thinking over all the names that she had ever heard and sent a messenger through the land to ask far and wide for all the names that could be found. And when the little man came the next day, he said,
So, do you think you have thought of what my name could be?
I have a parchment filled with names, little man. Listen.
And she began to read, beginning with Caspar, Melchior, and Balthazar. She repeated all she knew, while the little man listened with a shaking head. The queen went through the whole list, but after each, the little man said, with a sly smirk,
"That is not my name."
The second day, the queen sent to inquire of all the neighbors what the servants and laborers were called, and told the little man all the most unusual and singular names, saying,
"Perhaps you are called Roast Ribs, or Sheepshanks, or Spindleshanks."
But he answered nothing except,
"That is not my name."
On the third day, the messenger came back again, and he said to the young queen,
"I have not been able to find one single new name, but as I passed through the woods, I came to a high hill, and near it was a little house. Before the house burned a fire, and round the fire danced a comical little man, and as he hopped on one leg, he cried, 'Today do I bake, tomorrow I brew. The day after that, the queen's child comes in. And oh, I'm glad that nobody knew the name I'm called is Rumpelstiltskin.'"
You cannot think how pleased the queen was to hear that name. And soon afterwards, the little man walked in and said,
"Now then, Majesty, what is my name?"
And with a pretended hint of anxiousness in her voice, she said it first.
"Are you called Conrad?"
"No,"
answered he.
"Are you called Harry?"
she asked again.
"No,"
he chortled, and began to slowly move towards the child's cradle. And then the young queen said,
"Then perhaps your name is Rumpelstiltskin."
The little man wheeled around in shocked disbelief.
"The devil told you that! The devil told you that!"
he cried out in his rage, and the little man was so overwhelmed with his anger that he stamped his right foot so hard that it went down into the ground above his knee. Then he seized his left foot with both of his hands and pulled in such a fury that he split himself in two. And there was the end of him.
Holy cow! Then what happened?
Yeah, Grandpa, what happened then?
What do you mean, what happened? Nothing happened. That's the end of the story.
But that can't be the end of the story. It doesn't seem finished to me.
Yeah, Grandpa, there's gotta be more.
Well, I don't have a clue. How would you two end it then?
Well, the queen could tell the king that she couldn't really spin straw into gold.
Because you know he's gonna want more gold at some point. And when he found out that the one who could do it, Rumpelstiltskin, is dead, he'd get really mad.
And then she'd take off her wedding ring and throw it down, and she'd stomp out of the castle with her baby.
And she'd go back home to her pa, and he'd say he's sorry to her for being so foolish, as to tell the king she could spin straw into gold.
And then she'd meet a kind man that she'd want to marry, and they'd get married.
And they'd have a baby, a little brother for the first child.
And after they grew up a little, she'd settle them down by the fire on a cold and blustery winter's night and tell them both the story of Rumpelstiltskin.
She was, moreover, very shrewd and clever, and the miller was so proud of her.